When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. It would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice in its eyes. His eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking, you know, the look it was giving me.
Welcome to Bigfoot Hotspot Radio, Sasquatch Chronicles. I'm your host, Wes, along with my brother, Woody, and researcher, author, and friend, William Jeffy. Let's start the show. This guy who sent me this email had some pretty creepy encounters in there. I mean, it was one after another, after another, after another, and some of the stuff was pretty hard to read. Like his dog, he showed up. Did you read that email I sent you?
I did read it, and it was interesting. Didn't he say just the skin was left?
Yeah, just the skin was left of his dog, and all the chickens were missing. But this guy had like five or six really creepy stories to tell of what happened on his farm.
Yeah, it should be really interesting to hear what he has to say.
Yeah, it should be really interesting. I want to welcome, we're not going to use his first name, we're going to use Ghost as we're going to refer to the guest tonight, but I want to welcome Ghost to the show, and he wants to share some of the encounters that had happened to him that were relayed to him to his from his father as they were growing up on a farm.
Hi, Ghost, how are you this evening?
I'm doing fine, how are you?
I'm good. Usually, when I talk to witnesses, I usually ask them what their knowledge was of the subject before they had an encounter. But you've had knowledge of this since you were very little. So let's just go ahead and start with the first story your father told you, sort of your introduction to the subject, and then we'll just go from there. How's that?
Yeah, that's fine. Well, basically, my father is a middle child. He had two brothers and two sisters, and he was right down in the middle. And he lived in Michigan most of his life and up in the northern states. And my grandfather was usually, during this time, he was working from one job to the next. And my grandfather, when this first encounter happened, was actually hauling an 18-wheeler. So he wasn't even on the property when this happened, and he actually was very shocked when he found out the end results, as you can imagine, when he got back from his travel. And so what ended up happening, as I've been told, is that my grandfather and my grandmother had purchased some property outside this town in Michigan, and they had a chicken coop, but they used a kind of like a trailer, an RV trailer of some kind. I don't know exactly what it was, but he related to me like it was a camper. And they tore out the inside of it and made a chicken coop. And I'm not sure exactly how they did this, but my father and my uncle, I'll just refer to him as Uncle Y, expressed to me that the only way to get inside of the coup was to go underneath the camper, and they had made a latch out of the floor. so you could unlock the latch and go inside and then, you know, gather your eggs or, you know, whatever, and then leave, and you would close it in and hatch it again. So they didn't go through the side door or anything like that. And my grandfather actually got a Malmute, this great big old Malmute, to protect the chicken coop. And it was attached to this chain that went right underneath where the latch was. So anything that tried, like, you know, any coyotes or bobcats or anything try to go near there, you know, that Malmute was just always on them instantly, always there, you know. According to all my aunts and uncles and my grandmother, that Malmute was not scared of anything. And it was the friendliest dog when, you know, it to the family members and to friends. But any animal at all that came near that property, that Malmute was right on it. And it would alert them to anything. And so this one particular night when this encounter happened, my grandfather was gone, and it was nighttime. I don't know what time it was specifically, but I know that it was exceptionally dark. According to my Uncle Y, he said that it was very, 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 very dark outside. And he said that he just felt something was wrong. He was just very, very scared. And this happened between 1977 through 78. So they were pretty young. I don't know exactly how young, but they were young boys. And probably I'd estimate between ages 6 to 11. But he was very scared for some reason. And they were all in bed. My grandma was out knitting in the living room. And out of nowhere, they just all smelled this really, really terrible, terrible smell. And they just, they never smelled anything like it before. And instantly, boom, the Malmute was tearing up. I mean, it went ballistic and just screaming and hollering and making a racket, barking its head off. And this went on for some time. And my grandma didn't know what was going on. She thought it was probably just, you know, a skunk or a raccoon or something. But, man, I can't even describe the sounds that, according to my father, this thing made. At about 6 minutes or 5 minutes after the Malmute had started barking, there was this huge, it wasn't a roar, but this huge, deep, loud, kind of semi-moan roar thing just came out of nowhere. And it, according to my father, it got higher in pitch, and it was very long vocally. Like, it was a very, very long, like a sustained note or something. That's really the only way I could describe it. And it just got higher and higher and higher in pitch. And instantly, my grandma was scared. You know, her hairs went up. All the kids woke up. And they didn't know what was going on. And they said that they heard the Malmute actually cry like it was scared. And they could hear the chain on the ground go. They didn't see it, but they believed that it went under the camper because they could hear the chain kind of being dragged as it was walking or running. And there was this deep, deep silence. And then my father says they could hear the chain actually being pulled against the ground, that something was pulling the dog out from under the camper, and the dog was, you know, whimpering and crying and scared, and there was this massive commotion. At one point, that, you know, something got a hold of the dog. And, you know, they could just hear it. They could just hear this dog fighting for its life. And my uncle got so scared, he wanted to run out and see what was going on. And that's Uncle Y. And Uncle Y stood up and turned to look out the window. And he said, he swears up and down that there are these, something was staring at him. And he just was struck with sheer terror, and he said that it had red eyes. I think it was the way the light from around the house was that they had lights on their house. I think that maybe the light was reflecting it or something like that. I'm not sure. I wasn't there, but she says this thing had red eyes. And it was staring at him through the window. And he just kind of panicked almost and ran and hid under the bed. He was just so scared. When my father saw him run and hide under the bed, he actually joined him under the bed because he was scared. And around the same time that happened with Uncle Y, one of my aunts also saw something staring at her through her window. And she says it had red eyes, and it scared her very, very bad. But that's all she told me. She won't tell me anything more than that. And my grandma said she got up to go check on the dog because of the fighting that was going on. She looked out the window, and she saw red eyes staring at her, and that really scared her. At that point, she made sure the doors were all locked. She was scared. She just said that she started praying. She was hoping that daybreak would come soon. You know, she was scared that something was going to happen to the kids, and she didn't know what was going to happen. And so that was pretty much the first encounter. And when day eventually came, they went outside. And this part is hard for me to know because all of my family kind of don't like talking about this. But according to my father, when they went outside and there were feet print all over, there were chicken feathers all over the place. And the only thing that was left of the dog was the skin off its back. But according to my Uncle Y, he says that the dog was actually like torn to pieces, and that there were parts of it. I don't know which one is true. I don't know if maybe my Uncle Y actually walked around and saw more than my dad did, but my dad says that all he saw was the skin of its back. But my uncle says that it was actually ripped apart. And they went in the chicken coop, and something had literally climbed under the chicken coop, opened the hatch, and stole all the, there was not a single chicken left. The thing about this incident is my family, they won't talk about this. There's, you know, because you have skeptics, you know, criticize them, you know, you're crazy, making it up. Exactly. And my grandma, she'll say she thinks it's a bear, but she says that because she'll say that to strangers, but if you get her or any of my family members behind closed doors, they'll tell you, they thought it was a Bigfoot because, there's no way that any animal could open that hatch unless it had closable thumbs. There's just no way. They've seen bears. They lived in Michigan. They know what bears sound like and smell like, and that didn't sound anything at all, according to them, like a bear encounter. But they won't talk about it. And, you know, that's part of the reason why I don't personally want to reveal my name, is because they'll get angry with me about talking about this, because they just, you know, they don't want to deal with all the, you know, ridicule and all that.
It's interesting you bring up the Malamute. Mm-hmm. You know, I used to own a Malamute, and those dogs are stubborn as hell. There's not an animal on this planet that they won't back down from. God, I can't even imagine.
And, you know, and with chickens, the way they were taken out of an enclosure that was impossible for another animal to get out of, I can think of another example that happened in Roy, Washington like that. And this was also the late 70s, where a friend of mine, they had some rabbit pens, and they were built very sturdy, heavy 2x6 boards and heavy gauge mesh wiring. And the bottoms were ripped open like you'd open a tin can. And there was no way in the world any animal could get under on its back, you know, with about 18 inches of clearance, and open them that way. And all the rabbits were gone. And the same thing, there was skin and hair all over the yard. And the rabbits were all gone. So very similar type of situation.
Yeah, I find it interesting, too, because Ghost talks about the different family members talking about the red eyes from different pinpoints around the house, mm-hmm. almost like they were surrounded by the Bigfoot Mafia when they came in. Yeah, it was a coordinated attack. That's exactly what it sounds like.
That's what I've been led to believe. Unfortunately, that's just my own personal speculation. I believe that they were surrounded, or at least like they were making sure that no one came out of the house while they were taking their prey, the chickens or anything, to kind of protect those that were running off with them. But it's just one of those things that all we can do is just retell the tale and just speculate about it. But I mean, yeah. it's really terrifying to me to think that something like that could happen, and there's like nothing you could really do about it. You know,
it's an unimaginable situation to be in, I think, for most of us.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it is terrifying. You know, take my freaking chickens, but don't take my dog. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and you know, the whole idea that, as you know, I mean, I was always involved kind of with studying Bigfoot and Yeti and all that kind of stuff growing up, and I read books, you know, fan fiction and all that stuff about, you know, Bigfoot being a protective guardian or a friend and all this stuff, and that's all bull crap, you know. I mean,
it's a silly idea.
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, people go out, you know, you have these television shows where they try to go out and find these things, and they don't even know what they're dealing with. These things are dangerous, and they'll, you know, you can get you could get hurt, you know, and it's just, people need to be aware that what they're getting involved with.
All the time, if nothing else, they're wild creatures. You're not going to go out and grab a bear or a cougar or a wolf or something like that and try to make friends with it, because the consequences are going to be you're going to get injured or possibly killed. You know,
exactly.
Any wild animal. You don't mess with wild animals.
Exactly. And these things are almost three times our size. Who knows how powerful, you know, they're predators. You got story after story after story, especially in the Native American lore of these
so
things
many.
Eating people. You
you're
know,
absolutely
and it's
correct.
It's just people need to, if people are going to go squatching or anything, at least they should be aware and be safe about it, have
you've
something
have
to protect
the right
themselves.
Mindset. Yeah, you've got to have
exactly.
the right mindset for certain.
Exactly.
Well, Ghost, tell us your next encounter.
Well, the next encounter happened with my Uncle Y, and I think he was the one who was actually the most scared of this encounter. And he, again, all these encounters that I'm aware of happened in Michigan, because that is where the bulk of my family lives, is up in Michigan, up in the, by those, the Canadian border. And he was actually out hunting with some of his friends. Now, this story, I personally have not been able to verify if this is true or not, but he swears up and down that it is. And the thing about my uncle is that when you question him about if this is true or not, he doesn't get upset because you don't believe the story. He gets upset because, in essence, you're calling him a liar. And that really, really upsets him, that because he wouldn't lie, you know, about something like this. But he claims he was out hunting with his friends. And they were out and deep in the woods, and he caught that same smell, same exact scent. And in his mind, he knew immediately what it was, because it had shook him up so bad. I mean, after what happened to the dog and the chickens and that whole nine yards, it's just not something that I don't think anyone would really forget.
Pretty traumatic event.
Right. And he knew immediately what it was. But he didn't tell anybody anything about this. And his friends started, you know, saying, "What, man, is that a skunk or what?" And he was just telling them, we need to go. We need to get out of here. You know, this area is not safe. We need to go home. Look, we'll continue hunting some other time." And they're like, "Why are you so scared? You don't act like this before. Why are you so scared, you know?" And he told them, "Well, there's a Bigfoot in the area." Oh, as soon as he said that, "Ha ha, you know, you're an idiot. Oh, you're stupid, you know, the whole nine yards," making fun of him. And my uncle, he can't stand that. You know, he's got kind of a pride, and he gets really angry, and he's like, "All right, you're going to regret it. We're staying here. You don't believe me? You watch. Something's going to happen. You're going to see something." And so, you know, they all stayed the night. They were all camped out. And the next day, about 5 to 7 miles away from their campsite, it was in the news in the town that something had carried a cow over a 6-foot fence and had kind of gutted. It had removed its organs. I don't know exactly what organs, but he says that the carcass was on the other side of the fence, but left on the other side of the fence, and that things like its heart was gone, and I think he said its liver. I don't remember, but the cow was dead, and a lot of its organs were missing. And there had been several Bigfoot sightings the night before around in that area, and that really just kind of spooked his friends, you know. And you know, all he really told them was, you know, I told you that there was something out there.
Well, that would certainly get your attention.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, the thing about that is, that would mean that something carried, I don't know anything that can carry a cow, let alone over a 6-foot fence.
I was just thinking the same thing. You know, what can carry a cow over a 6-foot fence? I can tell you the creatures I saw that night probably could, but other than that, I don't know what else could carry a cow over a 6-foot fence.
I guess it would depend on the size of the cow, too.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I mean,
even a small cow. Even a small cow, I don't know if you can carry over a 6-foot fence.
Right.
Well, you know, we did have the situation in 1980 near Mount Rainier where two elk were torn apart by a couple of Sasquatches. So, you know, an elk is comparable to a cow easily, you know, in size and weight.
Mm-hmm. I guess the most shocking and scary thing about this is about just the concept of Bigfoot or Sasquatch in general is the unspoken amount of power they have. I mean, you really don't know. We don't know how powerful they really are. I mean, we know that they're powerful enough to kill you, but, you know, it's just that they're so quiet and so stealthy and so powerful. You just have, it's so overwhelming.
It's very unnerving.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
You know, especially for us where we tend to think that we're the most, you know, powerful thing on the planet, and then to find out that we're not. It is a little unnerving.
It is unnerving. You know, like with our encounter with Woody and I remember thinking that the thing could tip the car over or throw the car that we were in. And we were in a pretty big SUV. And I remember seeing the size of the thing thinking, wow, this thing could probably throw this car we're in with us in it. And so I think the unknown is very unnerving, like you said, Will.
Yeah, and for people that have seen the Sasquatch, you know, you realize all of a sudden just how massive these things are. And it's just incomprehensible unless you've actually seen one. And even when you have seen one, it takes a long, long time to really kind of incorporate that into your thinking and come to terms with it.
Well, I know that just from the stories and stuff that I read and heard of, it's not something that I personally would ever want to encounter. I mean, I think I'd probably just lose my mind if I even laid my eyes on one in the wild. And I, you know, growing up as a kid, I always had fun playing in the woods. You know, it's just you always have kind of that look over your shoulder kind of thing when you hear about things like this when you're out there. But, I mean, it was fun playing out there. You just kind of let your imagination take over and go out there. And I wasn't scared of the woods at all. It was what was in the woods that I didn't see that kind of spooked me from time to time. Always made sure not to be out there, around 6 or 5 or whenever the sun started setting. I always made sure to hightail it out of there. I mean, I had a blast in there. You know, I always love going on nature trails and walks and stuff, but if you ever, you know, truly do Sasquatch research, you know, or anything, you'll come to realize, you know, that there's a lot of dangerous areas in the U.S. where these things roam around. I mean, I don't think people truly understand or grasp the wild expansiveness of the woods that we have in the United States. You know, I mean, we see all these cities and stuff like that and think that everything is civilized. But, I mean, even up in Michigan and, you know, all the way out on the West Coast and stuff, you got just massive and massive lands.
Huge areas, you're right.
You know, it's just mind-boggling, you know. And
I go to places where you can be in there for 1 to 2 weeks and never see another human being.
Exactly. I mean, you just could completely disappear right off the grid.
Absolutely. Yeah, you're right. You're right. There was one other encounter you were going to tell us about?
Right. The third encounter happened with my two cousins. And these are, ironically, my cousins from my Uncle Y and his sons. They never believed my uncle. This is what's funny about this. They never believed my uncle when he'd tell them these things and tell them, you know, be careful when you're out there hunting, you know. Don't, if you smell something unnatural, you know, you come home. You don't stay out there. I don't want you staying out there by yourselves. And, you know, they would always say, you know, you're scared of Bigfoot, you know, he's going to come get you, you know, kind of, my uncle Y was just hammered with ridicule from everywhere. I mean, his own family, you know, his kids and his friends, and so he just stopped telling people, you know. I mean, he won't tell you unless he's alone with you. But this night, my cousins were driving home, and they were, I think this was in 2005, maybe 2004, and this is what's strange about this is I think it was last week's caller told a very, very similar story to this, to what happened to them. They were going down the road to their house, and where they live at has some woods. It's not a massive amount of expansive woodland, but there's a fairly good amount of land out there that's wooded. And they came across this corner where this cemetery is. And the cemetery has only one light. It has only one spotlight down. And they turned down this corner this night, and they said that they immediately saw this thing standing under the light. The light was reflecting off of its fur or its hair. They knew instantly what it was. They were instantly gripped with fear. And my cousin who was driving actually fainted out of fear. And my other cousin who was in the passenger seat, had to slam on the brakes and pull up the emergency brake to get the car to stop, is what he says, because my other cousin, he doesn't remember anything, the one that fainted. He says he doesn't recall anything. But my other cousin knew that he needed to get in the driver's seat to drive off and get away, but he was so scared to get out of the car that he thought he was literally going to die if he got out of the car. He thought that this thing would come and attack him. I think they were probably, they've taken me to where this thing, to where they saw it, and I believe that it was probably within about, I'd say 17 feet, maybe 20 feet or so, and he was just gripped with terror, and he eventually got out of the car and looked, and it was gone. And he looked behind him, and there were other vehicles behind him where people were getting out of the car with flashlights because they were perplexed. They saw it too, and they wanted to confirm, or what he says he believed, they were trying to confirm what they saw. And it kind of reminded me of what the gentleman said on the last show, where people were coming out of their car to see if they saw it or to verify that they saw it. And he got in the car and drove off. But when he talks about this, it really shakes him up. And my other cousin, you know, he doesn't remember anything besides seeing it and then just nothing else because he fainted. To me, I would be with my cousin, you know, that didn't want to get out of the car. I wouldn't want to, you know, grab a flashlight and be like, oh, did I really see that, you know, or whatever. I would just get and go, you know, get on the other side and just drive off, you know. I mean, I don't need to go poke at this thing, you know, and say, oh, are you real, you know, or anything like that, no, you know. But to me, I mean, it's always been something that has kind of been a fear of mine, and I don't want to, not like a irrational fear, I don't want to say, but more so of a fear of something that I don't ever want to have to deal with or encounter with, because I've talked to other people, other individuals who have claimed to have encounters, and their stories are just so shocking, just so scary in nature, that it's, why would I want to subject myself to that? You know, why would I want to verify for myself by seeing it? Because to me, it does exist. I mean, you have story after story after story in our time that it's almost exactly the same as story after story after story of thousands and thousands of years ago. And that, to me, is evidence enough. You know, why would people still today be telling the same things that other people thousands of years ago told, unless that there was some truth to it?
Yeah, if they were fake or made up, the stories would deviate, but they don't deviate. They like you said, your cousin's encounter was very similar to the person we had last week, and that's true. The authentic accounts do repeat.
Are you familiar with David Politis's work with Mission 411 and Tribal Bigfoot and all the other material that he's been working on?
Somewhat, yes.
I actually was very surprised with some of his stuff because you can actually take, for example, I've been reading his Missing 411 series about people who just disappear in the wilderness and some of them are never seen again, some of them are found dead, some of them are found alive. And what he calls as, I believe that they're grid points, I can't remember the exact term that he used, but they're like hot spots almost of where people disappear, like up in the Appalachian Trail or in the Smoky Mountains and stuff like that. If you take those spots and you line them up with Bigfoot sightings or with legends from Native Americans of Bigfoot, they line up almost exactly the same way. A lot of these people disappear places that Native Americans told other people, their members, not to go to because bad things would happen, such as Devil's Peak or Devil's Canyon, and you know, things like that that have names like that. It's like, why do they have names like that? Why would they name them something like that? Mm-hmm. There's too much evidence to show otherwise that these things would not exist. You know, the further back you go, we have encounters, we have hair, we have fingerprints. Or I'm sorry, we have footprints, we have unknown DNA, we have an eyewitness accounts, we have vocalizations, the whole nine yards. The only thing that we lack is a body.
On your parents' property, did they ever mention anything else that had happened around the property besides that one incident?
They noticed that they would get feet prints going around the area a lot up in Michigan. They don't live there anymore. They moved out and right away after that happened. When my grandpa got back, they packed up and they left. But they had heard stories from neighbors, allegedly, that there were strange things going around happening in the area, and they didn't know what it was. That their animals were acting weird. They didn't know what was going on. They had never seen anything like this before. They thought that there might have been some kind of rabid bear babies or something. They didn't know what the deal was. And the local town newspaper actually went and took pictures of these feet prints, and they took casts of them and everything. And allegedly, you can still see those casts up in that town to this day. My father wants to actually take me up there to see them. I have not seen them myself. But according to the family, those casts are there, and that is supposed to have made local news there. I don't think it made state news or anything like that, but it's just something, you know, people should be aware that these things are not your buddy like Smokey the Bear or something like that, you know, that they're going to protect you or, you know, just try and communicate with you and play with you or anything like that. These things are predators. These things are ambushers. These things will cause you harm. And the Native Americans...
You're right on the mark with that.
Native Americans, you know, they don't even like to talk about them. You know, you have a hard time having tribes open up about them, and the whole, you know, we traded with them, that goes back way, 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 way back, almost to like first encounters with them. But almost immediately after that, with Native American stories, and you have to really kind of dig. I don't have to tell you guys this. I'm sure you already know. But if you really start digging in it, you'll find that Native Americans actually tried to exterminate these things because they kept kidnapping kids and eating them, allegedly. Or they kept attacking villages and stuff. And, I mean, you can look story up after story. You got things like, you know, the Roosevelt story, you have LaFleur's story, I mean, you have the Prospector story of these aggressive attacks, and the only story that I ever came across where these things were nice or allegedly were nice to a human, I read in one of those Bigfoot kind of, it was a really short book. It just had pictures of the Patterson film in there and stuff. And it was the story, I can't remember the gentleman's name, but he was in a sleeping bag, and it apparently it picked him up and took him to his cave, and it just kind of held him there.
Albert Ostman.
Yes, yeah. Exactly.
And I'll tell you something, you know, Rene de Hinden was a longtime friend of mine, and he was the one who was the primary and the first interviewer of Ostman. And Rene told me, and this was back in the late 80s, he said, we were talking one evening at his house. He says, you know, I interviewed Ostman over and over for many years. And he says, you know, in the end, I think he made the whole thing up.
Well, it just wouldn't make sense. Why would they take a human and just leave him there in the cave and just not let him leave? That doesn't make sense. That's the only... I mean, you can usually spot a fake story out when it comes to Bigfoot encounters, if you actually know the history of Sasquatch. If you don't know the history, then you're not going to know the difference.
Exactly. You're exactly right, because these, again, like I said, these legitimate stories, at least some of the major details will repeat over and over again. The ones that are fake are that you might hear once, like, but in this case, it's the only story like that. You know, so that's a red flag right there.
Right, and, you know, a lot of people, to me, something that just kind of sticks out to me is that a lot of people that tell their stories or want to tell their stories usually don't care most of the time what people think about them because they know what they saw or experienced, and they're more or less trying to just let people be aware to be safe. And that's my whole point. You know, I don't want any gain out of this or anything. I just want people to know the truth that if you're going to go out in the woods, be safe because things happen, you know, accidents happen, you know, but these things, they're not scared of us by ourselves. You know, as you have pointed out, they stay away from groups or at least are cautious around groups. So if you go camping or something, be in a pretty large group, you know, maybe about 6 people or so. But if you're going by yourself, you know, be exceptionally safe because you don't know what's out there or in the area unless you're really, really, really familiar with it, you know. And yeah. I just don't.
Yeah,
I just,
and even from the standpoint, like with cougar attacks have increased over the past, you know, decade or so. You know, it's just not, or if you, you know, trip and fall and break a leg or something. I mean, there's just a lot of reasons not to go by yourself.
Exactly.
Bigfoot, you know.
Exactly.
But,
you know, you dehydration and...
Oh, yeah,
yeah,
there's lots and lots of things that can happen. So, you know, it's never a good idea to go by yourself.
Exactly. I was actually curious. I stumbled across this fairly recently. I'm not sure if this is new or old. Concept about you know, big feet burying their dead, but you know that's been kind of around. But are you familiar with LaFleur's Bigfoot encounter?
I'm not. No.
Well, he was allegedly in Oklahoma in 1855. He was a Native American who led other Native Americans to wipe out a Bigfoot family group that had been raiding the area, and they had killed many, many, many children. And LaFleur, when he got in the area, he they smelled a stench of death. And when they broke this clearing, there's this big mound, this really, really large mound. Originally, the furthest text that you can find, it will say mountain, but other newer sources call it a mound. It was a really, really big mound. And that there were decomposing dead kids out that they had eaten and stuff. And instantly, they were charged by some large males. LaFleur allegedly, according to the story, he shot it with his revolver into it. It didn't do anything, and it ripped his head off just with a big sweep, just went boom, and took his head right off, which to me was when I heard one of your guest speakers talking about the story where he didn't believe it was true, but his friend believed it was true, where the Bigfoot ripped the guy's head off immediately after he shot one sitting in the clearing.
Jumbo told us that story, yeah.
That instantly reminded me of this story where it went straight for his head. It didn't go for his legs like a dog would, you know, to get the calf or anything like that. It just went straight, swiped, took his head right off, and he died. But according to the story, they actually killed these things, and they burned them. His Native American compatriots burned their corpses and buried the dead children. And in the mound were skeletons of deceased Bigfoots. And there's been kind of this idea that these mounds are actually burial mounds. I don't have any way to confirm this or anything. It's just, you know, again, speculation. But I was curious if you guys had heard anything about this before, especially because if you go back to when America was first being colonized, you have stories where some of the colonists had come across these big mounds, but they destroyed them for landscaping and to build their plantations or cities and et cetera, et cetera. But
in Washington and Oregon, so far, it's something Rene DeHinden again put me on to many years ago that he found. They're not large. Well, I can't say they're not large mounds. They're not really huge mounds in that term, but they're large enough to have covered a Sasquatch corpse. And so far I've got at least 8 sites, different sites in both states located. So that's one of our goals, you know, for my organization is to go out and to see if those actually are burial sites.
That's all I can say is, you know, to the listeners, so this is just, that's just speculation from my part and from what I've read online.
At this point, sure.
But I find it to be really interesting, and to me it would make logical sense, but there's no way to confirm that. I just find it to be very interesting because these things are exceptionally intelligent. At least I think they are. The way that they handle themselves.
All primates are very intelligent.
Mm-hmm.
It reminds me of Quentin's story he had posted on Facebook.
Yeah, right.
About the guy that shot one, they buried it. 100 stayed behind, and the other 100 decided to go get the authorities. They came back, and then they found the 100 that stayed behind with his head ripped off, his arms ripped
off,
and his body had been slammed up against trees. And the Sasquatch that they actually shot and had buried was gone. Something had dug it up and taken it.
I'm not too familiar with other primates. I'm not sure if they do anything like that, like a burial ceremony. But I do know that some of them mourn. You know, they get upset. They mourn the loss. Like if there's you got like the whole story of Tarzan, for example. I mean, the mother lost a child. The mother ape lost a child, and it mourned the death. It was so distraught and sad that it actually took the human child to replace the loneliness in its heart. You know, so I mean, these things, I'd say they have greater intelligence, and they know, you know, how to do things like that, I would assume.
Yeah, there's a primate in India that actually buries its dead.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, and with all the relic, or what we suspect are these relic hominids, you know, with all the big gaps in the hominid fossil record, we don't know where these things fall into place and what they know. It's same with Neanderthals, for example. There's, you know, all these people speak with all this great authority about them. There's a lot of things they don't know about them. you know, they weren't Homo sapiens, they were Neanderthals, they were a different species. And you know, they think they buried their dead sometimes, but it's not all the time. So we don't know what the other species did or didn't do. There's no way of knowing.
Right.
Right. It's interesting that you bring up Neanderthals, because I had also read that Neanderthals would commit cannibalism of their dead sometimes, and
right.
It just makes me kind of wonder if these things might do something similar like that, because they're something that big would need a lot of nutrition, nutrients, and vitamins.
Yeah, there's a lot
protein.
Of unknowns at this point.
Yeah,
it's certainly
right.
possible.
If those dirty monkeys will take your dog, I mean, who knows what else they'll do. I'm just joking.
Right.
Right.
And, you know,
damn dirty apes.
You're damn dirty apes. Right. Yeah, I mean, that's pretty much what it boils down to in essence. I mean, with the whole conflict that we had with these things back in those days when it was kind of like the book, that book, you know, us versus them. And
right.
It's more
right.
Less,
yeah, it sort
more
of makes
less
you think that, doesn't it?
Yeah. It kind of boggles my mind how people can compare these things to us. Like the Native Americans, you know, they would call them Big Brother, or, you know, that they would believe that these were humans. And to me, I'm thinking they're not Homo sapiens.
Well,
know?
here's something to consider. And I've mentioned this a couple times before on the show. Sometime last year, I was in touch with I was looking to get some permission from different Native artists to use photographs in some book projects. And one gentleman I contacted, I found, was actually a chief and an elder for his particular tribe. And he passed on some information to me that was very helpful. He says, when it comes to Native histories or names or experiences, things like that, he says you really have to, it's not never a blanket situation. It greatly depends on the tribe's experience. He said it could be a family's experience. He said it could boil right down to just an individual's experience on their outlook, you know, or the stories and how they're put together. So they're looked upon as a big brother. Maybe that was somebody's, you know, fanciful thinking, you know, at one point in their history. But when you, like you mentioned, when you look at the bulk of these tribal mm-hmm. accounts, they do refer to them in the negative. They're cannibalistic. They're, you know, these wild, vicious creatures. They're not mm-hmm. you know, something friendly to be, you know, admired. They're something to stay away from.
Mm-hmm. Kind of like the tormentor of Native American folklore, and, you know, not necessarily the prankster. That was always kind of, you know, making jokes or trying to pull a prank on someone.
Right.
More so like the terror of the story.
Absolutely.
You
know, like the boogeyman, the booger man.
Yeah, you know. Well, I mean, for me, in all honesty, he was. I mean, Bigfoot kind of was the boogeyman for me. Kind of in essence growing up, because I was, it's kind of funny how this played out, because when I was really, really young, at 3 years old, I saw the 1970 version of King Kong. I can't remember exactly what year it was. And that really kind of scared the crap out of me, to say the least. And then when I got a little bit older, I saw the Star Wars movie where the snow monster got Luke. And that scared me. And then I hear stories, you know, I heard the stories about Bigfoot and stuff from my family's experience. And I was just kind of like, you know, whoa, you know, kind of thing. It just was all so real for me.
People, number one, are attracted to how horror movies are such a prevalent thing with humans, why they're so
mm-hmm.
popular and have been. And then when you see images like that, you know, the big hairy, and that's always the monster in our mind is the big hairy boogeyman, you know, why is
mm-hmm.
it always that image that scares us the most? Was there something in our distant past that really ingrained that fear into us?
That's what I think, too.
Thing.
Kind of like in our genetic code or whatever, like our genetic memory.
Right.
I think you had mentioned something like that a couple episodes back, and I was really intrigued by that.
Yeah, I think Vendramini sort of, you know, he says that in his book, Them and Us, You know, of course, I don't know, you know, I don't particularly think Neanderthals were that creature. Maybe the Sasquatch is actually that creature, you know, that we had that encounter with, you know, all the animosity, you know, the fighting and such. But, you know, certainly, you know, it's prevalent not just among Native Americans, but many other cultures around the world in
exactly.
these regions, you know, in my family's from Norway, and I've got a couple of the friends who are also, and you know, in that part of the country, they call them trolls and frost giants, and
mm-hmm.
You know, yeah, it's, you know, Shrek isn't the troll, you know, that's what everybody thinks today, but it's actually, you know, when you talk about in stories, you know, the monster hiding under the bridge, waiting to eat people, well, you know, that brings us right back to the Native American stories about these creatures laying in wait to eat the lone hunter or children. And
yeah,
in other countries,
right.
It's not just a few, it's across the board.
Exactly. You know, and I was actually going to kind of bring that up, too, is that, you know, it's not just located only in one or two regions in the world. You can find stories of these kind of encounters with a hairy creature that could fit under the Sasquatch family tree or lineage all over the world. I mean, in Europe, you have... The wood wolf, you know?
Exactly. And that was very prevalent in the Dark Ages. Almost
mm-hmm.
everything was adorned with that. But it's, yeah, it's mostly the northern latitudes around the world.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, the Yeti and, you know, the skunk ape and the whole nine yards. I mean, you can almost go to almost any culture, and find a similarity between the two, or find something that could possibly relate to the same situation and scenario. You know, really the only area that I haven't found anything, but I haven't really checked that hard either, is in the Middle East. That's really the only area that I've not found anything like that.
I would think almost certainly there would be references everywhere, you know, throughout history.
Oh, yeah.
In one way or another, maybe, you know, we think, because, you know, we like to put our own current thoughts on what ancient peoples were talking about or referring to, and you know, that's always being revised, it seems like. So maybe there was an entirely different way and context they were being talked about.
Gus, we're just almost out of time. I wanted to ask you, hearing all of these encounters from your family, hearing the stories from your dad, has it changed your viewpoint as far as going out in the woods? God, I would imagine it would.
Oh, absolutely it has. You know, I actually have, I don't know what it's called, I have a phobia of windows, actually. My fear is, I don't know what's on the other side looking in at me. And I've always had that fear, but it was really ingrained within me whenever I went to visit my grandma, because she lived out in a wooded, really wooded area, and I would always sleep in a room where there was a human-sized window right next to the bed that had no curtains. So and there was no light on the outside. So anything could just kind of walk up and stare in and look at me. And it just, like, I felt very exposed.
I would think growing up hearing those accounts would really, you know, make that pronounced, that fear.
Yeah, I would imagine.
Exactly. And so, you know, I kind of always nowadays make sure that my windows, I have real thick black curtains on my windows and stuff, but I don't like to go in the woods during, like, nighttime or anything. Obviously, I don't feel comfortable being in a tent. I don't feel comfortable being exposed to the elements. A lot of people will tell me, oh, well, you're missing out on camping, you're missing the experience. To me, it's just, it feels like I'm putting myself out there as an easy target for anything, not just Sasquatch, kind of like what you were talking about earlier. But I just feel very exposed, and so I kind of have to have a sense of security with me when I'm out in the woods. Speaking about how I would stay at my grandma's right quick, my cousins and myself, we would go out and we would play and stuff, but whenever it would get dark, I would always make sure that I was either by a campfire or inside where the adults were. And there were a couple of times where I was out in the woods by myself, but I can tell you I was scared like nothing else, you know what I mean? It was just something that just kind of I don't, like I said, it's not like I have an irrational fear. I mean, I like to go out and experience nature and everything, but it's just something that these things happen. Stories, you know, right. Where people just vanish and are gone and never seen again. And I kind of try and take that into consideration and try to make sure that I'm safe about it and whatnot. So
you have all this in the back of your mind when you're out. I think it's smart.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And that's my goal, is to try and hope that people will be smart when they're doing things out there, you know. Go out, have fun, play in the creek and the lake and stuff. I did. I had fun and a blast, but always make sure that you got an eye on the back of your head, because you don't know what's coming, you know.
And, you know, that's the problem with us today. You know, we've really dropped our guard from where our roots are as humans. You know, we just aren't as aware of our surroundings and what else is out there, and we really should be.
Oh, yeah.
I think a lot of bad things happen when we drop that guard.
Absolutely. Human beings, we are very, very vulnerable creatures. We are only the top because of our intelligence. But if we didn't have our intelligence, we would be easy pickings for almost all the predators.
I think there's a second part to that, and we tend to forget that, is that we are a very violent species.
Oh, yeah,
aggressive.
Absolutely.
Look what we do to each other as proof of that. And we've tried to get away from that, and that's how we've dropped our guard. I mean, there's a reason animals fear us and run.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
absolutely.
And we've dropped that. And the same with these creatures. Now, then that could have something to do with why we're getting more of these kinds of stories and things happening. I don't know. But certainly it's happening with cougars and things like that, because, you know, 30 years ago, we'd go out and shoot everything. And
absolutely.
All the years prior to that. And animals know we're dangerous species. Now that we've stopped doing that, that fear is going away.
Absolutely, you know. And it's kind of, I think you might have actually said something about this a couple weeks ago, where tracking and hunting it's really a learned art. You know, we really have to learn that, because of the history that we have with nature and the animals. They almost know we're in the area before we know they're in the area, and they will flee before we even realize that they were even there, you know. And you have to really learn how to get down in the mud and the dirt and track these things to go out and find them. To me, that just kind of enforces my opinion that we're really just very, very vulnerable creatures without our intelligence. If we lacked our intelligence, we'd be really, really easy pickings. I mean, we're strong, family, organized community creatures. We're very sociable creatures, but it's really our intelligence that gives us the edge over everything else.
We're great in numbers.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, Ghost, I can't thank you enough for coming on. I can't thank you enough for sharing the stories from what's happened to your family. I know it's tough to come out, and it's really tough to share those experiences and everything that's happened within your family. I know the ridicule. God, when you have your own encounter, it's hard to get your own family to believe what you've seen, let alone share it. And so I know it's tough to, and I really know it's tough to come out and share it on the air. And we can't thank you enough. Thank you so much for coming on the show and sharing your experiences. Yeah, very much. Very much so.
Absolutely. You know, I'm glad that you guys are an outlet for people to warn and to let people know about their encounters and the dangers out there, and, you know, just kind of a therapeutic session for people. And I think that's great that you're doing that. And your show reaches a lot of people, and a lot of people, I believe, are starting to realize the truth of the matter, and that is that these things do exist. They are dangerous, and we don't want to cause a panic or anything, but, you know, just be safe.
Just,
you know,
be aware.
Be safe, be smart.
Yeah.
Exactly. You know, and got to do what you got to do in order to make sure that, you know, you are safe with your family, if you, you know,
right.
have a family. But
yeah.
Thank you very much. You know, I appreciate you guys taking my call and letting me tell that story, and just hope that, you know, you guys keep doing what you're doing, because a lot of people enjoy it and a lot of people respect it.
No,
well,
thank you,
appreciate
and appreciate
everybody
it.
Listening and sharing their stories too.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, I guess I'll go ahead and let you guys go and look forward to hearing back from you guys sometime.
Everyone here at Bigfoot Hotspot Radio would like to thank Audible.com. Audible.com is the internet leading provider of audiobooks with over 150,000 different titles to choose from. To download a free audiobook of your choice, go to audibletrial.com/Bigfoot Hotspot. So I want to thank Ghost for being on the show. I want to thank him for sharing his encounters. Next week, we'll address rock throwing and other behaviors of Sasquatch, but I want to bring Bob on. Bob Garrett, I know Jamie had sent us this video and posted it on our Facebook fan page, on the Bigfoot Hotspot Radio fan page, of this camp that Bob came across. And so we thought we'd bring him on the show to have him discuss. I mean, it looked like someone had been... It looked like King Kong went through the area and basically had taken the campers and just destroyed the whole area. What did you think of that video?
Yeah, it wasn't just the camp, but the surrounding area was trashed as well.
Yeah, the surrounding areas. I mean, God, it looked like King Kong went through there. I mean, I would almost call it a hoax, not knowing Bob Garrett and not knowing anything about the video, except for a lot of the surrounding areas that you see. I mean, there is no way a person could have done the damage that was done on this place.
Yeah. Bob Garrett's a very credible Bigfoot hunter. I mean, him and Lupe Mendoza and some of the folks that they have in their group in Texas are some of the few that I consider very good in this field.
Well, let's go ahead and bring Bob on.
How you guys doing?
Well, we're doing pretty good. You're in the field, huh?
Yes, I am. I just got back up to the truck, and we're going to roll over to an area where the service is better.
And Bob, the reason why, someone had posted one of your videos to our fan Facebook page. I know you all know each other, but some guy was asking me, is this real or not? It's the one where you came across the campsite, and it looked like King Kong had went through there.
Yeah, pretty much. Everything was just destroyed. The trees behind it was destroyed.
Well, let's do this. Will, do you want to interview Bob about that video? And then what I'd like to do, Bob, is get you on the show. Would you want to come on maybe next week and talk about beyond just the video? But would you be able, I mean, we had almost 3,000 people view your video in that one day after it was posted on our site. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. We have a huge audience.
Yeah, we get about 200, almost a quarter million people listen to us on a monthly basis, but I probably got about 30 emails after that video was posted. People were asking me, is this real or is this fake or is this hoaxed or what do you guys think about this? And I finally emailed Will and said, it looks legitimate. I mean, I didn't know anything about the video and I just said, well, if you look at the surrounding areas that the guy, and I didn't know you, Bob, but I said that the guy is actually, when he shows the trees and stuff that are torn out of the area, I mean, God, a person couldn't do that. Well, we had a lot of people that, I'm getting emails left and right about that video. People are asking me if that's real or if that's hoaxed or, and so that's why we wanted to have you on. So I was wondering if maybe, and Will kind of ask you questions as we go, but maybe we can talk about the video, but I'd like to have you on next week if that'd be possible to have you talk about what you're doing in your area and kind of what you're seeing and experiences that you've had, if that'd be all right.
Yeah, that would be fine. I'm sorry that I'm in the field tonight.
No apologies.
Everything.
Don't apologize. I tell people you're one of the best out there, so, you know, you got to keep doing what you're doing, man.
Man, I appreciate that, believe me.
Well, I don't say it unless I believe it, so, you know.
Oh, I know that.
Go ahead and tell us what led up to that, and then walk us through that situation.
Okay. What we were doing was we had come down to an area that was actually about 20 miles from there, from where the torn-up camp was. And incidentally, we call it the hidden camp because there's a camp in there that's hidden, and we use that quite often. We had left this area, and we came up in there, and we saw fire, and we noticed that the logs were had been spread around all over the place. Then we saw the tent. And then we saw all the debris thrown out into the middle of the road. I was concerned that possibly there had been a fight and somebody was probably needing assistance or something like that. And when I got out, that was my first thought, was that I needed to probably assist somebody and call the sheriff department, have them come out there. Then I got to noticing that, there was charcoal all over the place. There was toilet paper all over the place. There was the tent had been torn apart. It had been also burned, and it was a brand new tent. There was chicken laying around where apparently they must have just started cooking, because it was still fairly half raw, and bites were taken out of it. Just everything was just thrown completely out of the tent. Everything behind the tent was just basically destroyed, knocked down. The trees were knocked down. And you know, a human being, you know, even a lot of those trees that are dead are not going to be able to knock those size trees down.
Right, right.
And, we started getting some strange sounds after, you know, we had gotten out there, and they kind of sounded like a blowing. And I told Travis that, that's not a deer, because it was like blowing through lips and sucking back in. And it wasn't too far from us. And then down on the other side of the road, we were getting, you know, the same thing. My little handy cam didn't pick up the sound. As you can see in the video, we looked all around, and we looked into the tent. At first, I thought there was a body in the tent, and that's why we were looking into the tent. And I didn't want to leave somebody out there stranded, dead or alive. And I told my son, Travis, that, you know, we needed to report it, and we did. Okay, as we looked around and waited for someone to come, we began to notice that there were ants all over the ground. There by the tent, there was actually skin that looked like it had been pulled off of something or someone or whatever. We didn't know, and I don't even know what kind of skin it was. But it was laying there, and I think I addressed it in the video itself. We went out into the road. I was pretty sure that what went on here was probably Sasquatch activity. I'm not saying it was. I'm saying that I'm pretty sure that it was.
Right.
And we went out in the road. I started looking for tracks because it looked like, you know, there had just been a huge fight there. And we found footprints that were, large. And they were barefooted, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It, you know, very large toes and some that were a little smaller. And we studied that for a while. And realized that, yes, I'm pretty sure that this is Sasquatch activity. And the reason why I am sure of that is because they camped right on their corridor. They run this that area. And there's a trail that runs in there and goes all the way down along the lake. And, you know, for several miles, it goes to the south. And their trail is there. It's very, very well established. You can see that they use it all the time. And they come in, they pass that area, they go on through, and they go, you know, to the south, to the other end of the lake. Actually, what happens is they turn west. I've been out there for about 25 years, and I've mapped all this. I've spent a lot of time out there in the woods, you know, camping and just up in the middle of nowhere. But anyway, to get back to the camp, yeah, it's real. It really happened. We were scared. I mean, I would presume people would hear that in our voice. And yeah. We did call the authorities, and there were some things that we went back the next day and we found. As far as the hibachi that apparently had been thrown way up into the woods, bags, you know, sleeping bags, and you know, many other things.
To actually paint a picture for everyone, you guys show up, and I'm assuming this is a research area. You sound like you know it really well. For people who haven't seen the video, basically you guys show up, you guys see this, what looks like a campsite. The tent's half torn apart. You guys noticed the fire pit had been, the actual fire logs had been thrown out of the fire logs. There's trash everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And you wouldn't think, in my mind, you wouldn't think Sasquatch at first until you keep watching the video. And as you guys start panning around and you start showing different trees that have been ripped off, I think one of the trees you had shown had been snapped at like 8 feet up. There was trees that were the size of, I mean, stuff
13, 15 inches round or more.
Yeah, just snapped. And then I noticed the footprints you guys actually started showing. You started looking down, and you're like, oh, there's a footprint. Oh, there's a footprint. Oh, there's a footprint. And there's different sizes of what looks like bare footprints in the tracks. And this is a research area of your guys'.
Yes, we have been in this area for about 25 years. We've been researching there, and we have got a lot of stories to tell about that place.
We can't wait to hear them next week. But so you guys, should you guys finally report it to the authorities?
Yes, I did. We reported it to the authorities, and no one, well, okay, what happened is this. Okay, we went back the next day during the day, and I made a little bit of film, but the park department was in there, okay, and they were cleaning up. And if you see on my YouTube the follow-up, it says, you know, follow-up at the torn-up camp, you can see, if you look at the camp, at that video at night, and then you look at what they were doing and what they did the next day and the day after that, you will see that they totally cleaned it up. They dumped new sand. They dumped, they put dirt over the campfire area, and they rolled back and forth on it.
They erased what happened.
They erased what happened. And if anybody can go, as a matter of fact, if I will show, I will give you that video of what happened after we reported it and what the authorities did, if you'd like to have that.
And it's very similar to what Wes, you know, when you had the broken trees, the sign you were telling me when you and I first started talking. Tell us that, Wes, you know, where that area was cleansed.
Yeah, we had come across an area, Bob, and this is prior to my brother and I's encounter. We had come across an area where it looked like healthy trees had been ripped out of the ground and thrown across the trail. We had seen footprints, and we'd seen a lot of hand-twisted trees. I mean, where it looks like you take a matchstick and just twist it. And I'm talking 6-7 inches around, like it was just hand-twisted around. And my brother and I had caught a lot of flack about it when we started telling people. So we thought, you know what, let's go back and let's get pictures. Because we didn't take pictures. We were freaked out by the whole thing. So we had left. We went back less than 30 days. And my comment at the time was the whole area looked like a crime scene had been cleaned up. You would have never known there was hand-twisted trees. You would have never known there was trees that had been yanked out of the ground and thrown across the trail. Yeah, you would never found any prints. The whole area looked like it was a crime scene that had been cleaned up is the best way I can describe it.
That's exactly what they did out here. And see, this isn't the only incident. Okay, a few months before this, we found another torn up camp. And it's also on my YouTube. This one had a lot of valuable equipment left. And that I don't think, you know, anybody would leave. But also, we found 45 rounds on all four corners of the camp. Okay, if you're thinking that somebody, you know, I mean, if you're going to shoot a pistol or whatever, you know, while you're out there, you know, you're going to stay in one spot. But they had moved around from one corner to the next like they were protecting themselves. And the thing that bothered me about it was that there were children's clothes, pajamas, there were children's sleeping bags, just everything, you know, thrown up to the trees. There were two or three tents that were down and torn up. There was magazines, clothes thrown everywhere, brand new, really nice stoves. One was bent, and they were thrown around. And, you know, and then we find this one, you know, a few months later.
Yeah, this is not a very unusual situation.
Yeah, this is not an isolated incident. And the cleanup is not an isolated thing. And to all the people out there, I want to say this was real. This really happened. I was scared. I hope y'all could tell that on the video. And also, I want to say something else, too. On the torn-up camp, there were drag marks also, like something or someone had been dragged out of the camp.
I was saying, I think it shows on the video, right?
Yeah, it does. Yeah.
And I you know, tell about it. Also, I don't know if anybody noticed or not, but there's a roll of toilet paper. And out on the road, and there's a big stain. I mean, a really big stain. It's blood, where it had soaked into the ground before we got there. And of course, I think I showed a lot of urination where there'd been urinating. You know, something had urinated here and there. You know, down along the trail and stuff like that.
What did the authorities say when you called them, Bob?
The usual, you know, who I was and, you know, what my emergency was and, you know, things of that sort. And I told them what, you know, we had found. And they told us that, you know, that someone would, you know, come out there, and no one ever did. And so we waited, and that's why we went back the next morning. And that's when we discovered that what was going on was they were cleaning it up.
Jeez.
And it's called the follow-up to the torn-up camp. It's on my YouTube, and it's right there for everybody to see what they did.
Yeah, I'll post it up on Facebook. I know the first video really caused a stir along, you know, with a lot of people that were asking. Will and I got multiple emails from people asking us if it was real or what we thought about it. When you watch it, I mean, the first one, I know the torn-up video camp, I think it's just over 20 minutes. The more and more you watch it, the more and more creepier it gets, the more and more, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it really starts thinking into you what's going on there.
Yeah.
Oh, guys, tell you what, if you'd have been standing out there, it was even more creepy.
I'm sure.
I don't know what to tell you.
I bet. It was creepy to watch because especially – Bob, you go beyond just the camp. You start going around and, you know, you start saying, hey, look at this tree, and hey, look at this tree, and hey, look at this tree. And then you start realizing, and then when you start getting into the footprints, did you ever hear anything about the missing people, or have you done any follow-up on what happened to those people?
You know, I'm not really sure if I'm supposed to say or not, but we were, I guess, basically interrogated for about 6 hours. And my son, one of my other sons, who actually wasn't there with us, he was interrogated for, you know, close to 7 or 8 hours. You know, what did they see? What did they hear? What did they tell you? And I don't know what all. But it was kind of, that was kind of creepy too.
Who interrogated you?
Man, I am not liberty to say.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
No,
I know
no,
that
no,
sounds
apologies.
Bad. But man, I got so much trouble because it was considered a crime scene. I'm just telling you that I just can't tell you guys.
No,
I'm not,
okay.
I'm not gonna say. I'm scared to this day. And I even I've even told everybody, you know, that if I come up on something like this again, I'm going to let somebody else report it. I'm not going to report it, and I'm not going to take video of it.
Yeah.
And I know that sounds bad, but I went through hell. My family went through hell, and I'm not going to do it again.
Yeah.
No, I can't blame you for that.
No apologies. Let's do this, Bob. Would you be willing to come on next week, talk about experiences that you've had on the show?
Oh, sure. I'll be more than willing to. As a matter of fact, we got more stories about the torn-up camp area.
Oh, great. Absolutely. That's great.
And my friend Tim Sermons is over here laughing because he was involved.
Yeah.
And it was quite scary, believe me.
Yeah. Don't let those government monkeys in suits shake you up.
Well, I'm not. I learned real quick that they weren't going to do anything that they said they were going to do to me, because they didn't want to go through the courts, and I don't think they actually wanted a judge or other authority to actually know what's going
right.
on.
Right.
And yeah, I know I'm talking about conspiracy theories and cover-ups and stuff like that, but man,
I don't
know what to tell you.
No, yeah. We know plenty of that information, so you're not alone in that one.
Yeah. We could tell you a lot more creepier stories about the government, a lot more insider information, the stuff that would, you know, that would make you go, what?
Oh, I'm quite sure. It's just that we were trying to do the right thing, and it bit us in the ass. Oh, pardon me.
No apologies. We appreciate you coming on, Bob, and talking about the video. And we can't wait to have you on next week, talk about some of the experiences that you've had. And
yeah, some we're really looking forward to.
Yeah, absolutely. I think a lot of people are excited to have you on, too. Well, thank you so much, Bob. We'll have you on next week.
Okay. I'll be looking forward to it.
All right, Bob. Well, be safe while you're out there.
That's right.
Well, we will. All right. And thank you very much for having me on, and I hope that helped a lot of your listeners. And if you have more questions about it, next week, I'll be happy to talk to you about it. And
I invite
anybody to go on and go on my YouTube. You guys go on my YouTube and put up the torn up lost camp, bad smells, follow-up of the torn up camp.
I'm going to go check out the follow-up one. I just saw the torn up camp one, but I'm going to go check out the follow-up one, the follow-up to the torn up camp.
Okay. Well, I appreciate it, guys. It was nice. And like I said, you know, let me know when you want me to, or call me when you're ready. Let me, you know, send me a line or whatever.
We will. And we'll have you on next week, Bob. Thanks so much.
All right. Bye-bye.
Thanks for listening in, everyone. be sure to come back next week. We're going to have Bob Garrett on again, and it'll be an exciting show.
Have a good night, everyone.